Okay, everyone. So in this little snippet, we are going to go through Jay's question where he's asking about building dynamic component blocks so that a click can dynamically load in the main component, which is loaded on a block on his home page. So we're just going to try and explore that a little bit and see if it's possible. All right, Drew.
Okay, so I come from the world of PHP and I love server-side includes. Hold on, my phone is, let me log out of it. There we go. Okay, so I have this main component, and what I want to do is kind of treat it just like I have this main page here, and it's already in here. And I basically, if we go here, you can see I have my sections. I have my header, which I can then sub on what I learned from the tutorials. And then I got the footer, and then I looked at it and I was like, wait, I saw your user login tutorial. And I was like, wait, well, those are all pages too. And I would just include them, whether it be a layover or if I just wanted the block to change. Well, then I could just kind of like encapsulate this in blocks and have my main zone right here be something that I could dynamically generate. So I'd have, let's say, my default page, which is the default home page over here. Mm-hmm. And what I would do is, if I was thinking of maybe some type of routing conditionals, in which when it reads the page, the conditional will come in and this block would say, all right, by default, if they're not logged in, they can see this, which will be the home, the static home tech page text, but in the future would have, let's say, news blocks that are specific mm-hmm. to I'm using Toxic Hustle to digest data, and I have news out news data for business, AI, machine learning, hip-hop music, artificial intelligence, the virtual worlds, blockchain, all of that. And then what I'm doing is whatever I use for posts on the site, I can then repurpose it. So if I use it for Discord, if I use it for a video, I would have a legacy of where all of the content was used, where it was referenced, and even with intellectual property, how I deal with music, being able to put that in MP3s, which producer did I work with, who mixed it, who mastered it, having all of that data in one place. So now what I could end up doing is, depending on who logged in, these blocks could potentially change. And dynamically, because I could use your data sets on the back end as a personalization engine, I could put keywords as tags, and these blocks could then load in based off of kind of what data. So if they aren't interested in blockchain, well, we're not going to show them anything blockchain related. Or if they're not into the music space or not a producer, and not going to be a contributor, then we don't need to show any contribution buttons or any contribution blocks or any data in their dashboard about how their music is doing, on what social profiles are, how's their assets doing on in what virtual world and how much is taken in. So really right now it's, how do I get this block to load here? And then what happens is now this home page would now have I could just build out these micro pages and then just load them at will and just kind of have conditional stacks to be able to pull them in and out, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. And I think the first thing you said too about PHP includes, mm-hmm. It's just to note, this might be a little different because once a page is included in Builder, it's like you have more like real-time access to it than like PHP is kind of like, you're going from top down and you're including and it's set on the server and it doesn't change. Builder's a little different mindset. So I think you'll find it's like, it's probably more versatile than you even expect. But yeah, I think like, so what you can do is you can have this main component And then in Builder, you can read the URL. So you have a couple things you can read. You can read stuff from the URL to know, you know, if maybe it's a news page versus a home page, if you have a setup like that. Or you can read user data from like the signed in user. And then you just run an action that loads different pages based on that data. So like, I don't know exactly what kind of stuff would change or how your setup would be. We can talk more specifically, but really,
so let's just say for this one, like yeah. I would just want to read the conditional to say, hey, if this person's default, like they don't have any login or anything else, like the static person coming to the page, this page would just load in here and which would then show up here.
Mm-hmm. So for component main on the page you're on right now,
yes,
you don't have to load in that extra page called main. You can just load default page right into that. And then you can change that later and load a different page instead. Mm-hmm. Or if you want, you can keep that main page in between. It's up to you.
One way I think we could show how this would work and like not have to like mess up the project that you've got in place, you know, like start making changes there before you know. Uh-huh. I could show how to do like how I could modify. We have that template for the SaaS starter. And I could make some modifications to it because it's got a similar type layout where when you come into the dashboard, it's got like this main area. And depending on what you click, it opens into that main area. So I could swap that to be like, well, I'll check the route and see what's after the slash or like, you know, question mark equals whatever or any, you can base it on anything because the conditional is just, does X equal Y? Cool, do this, otherwise do this, right? Right. So we could like set up a switch in there and I could just do one real quick and that might give you the concepts you need and then you'll go apply those.
Yeah, actually that is helpful because your SaaS model is kind of where I'm at, where I'm thinking of everything in the graph as entities. So Toxic Hustle is an entity in the system. Myself as an artist is an entity in the system and I contribute to the system. Mm-hmm. And each entity would kind of like be like your SaaS.
Yeah.
Which would be each enterprise would have its own independent data sets to handle their own thing. So it's kind of similar.
Yeah, I think that makes sense.
I'll stop my share.
Let me prep this real quick and I'll show my screen and we can just see how this works. So let's, one sec, let me, almost there. I just made like a brand new project using that template and then we'll just go off of that. So I make sure I have a user signed up in it. So we're not doing all those pieces too. Okay, cool. So let me show my screen. And all right. So this is that SaaS starter project in execution. And I just like signed up as a user. So basically I just made a new project, used that project as the template to start from. And I've got this whole thing. And then I went to preview and signed up as a user in it. And now I've got this set up. So if you click between these, what's happening is I'm taking it on click. I open a page into a main container here. So it's really similar in structure. So the way that looks, let me zoom in here on the app page. So this is like a blank container here that I just have called app content. It doesn't actually contain anything in it. And then
notes on them real quick too, just in case you guys noticed that he's using a div there instead of a container element. And it doesn't actually matter behind the scenes in Builder. They're interchangeable, but we made the component element so it's clearer when you build, like it's a helpful helper. But just in case you pick up on that and notice, really you can load a page into any other element.
Yeah.
So you're just using a div instead of a component, really just is a div.
Yeah. So basically the component lets you just select a predetermined page to load into it automatically. Like that's really all it's doing. It doesn't actually have any other special benefit. Just makes it a little easier for like a header or a footer where it's going to be static. Gotcha. For anything that's dynamic, I just put a div on there, style it how I want as the base. And then what I'll do is like, if you notice on here, if you go to page load, let's see, under page binding, I run the action open dashboard or the flow called open dashboard. Just every time the page loads, it's going to run this. So that basically opens a page, my dashboard page, into that app content container and does a set of other things too. So that opens this page into that container by default. So that main page default you were talking about, like every time I refresh, that's what it's doing there. So by doing it this way, I get to keep sort of like a component based page layout where I structure everything in separate pages. Gives you better control. It makes it to where like long-term when you come back to the project and you look at how things are structured, it's just going to be easier to debug and things like that. But then you control what goes into this main one based on these other actions. So for instance, if I go to the customers button and look at what happens on click there, that runs this flow called action open customers, which is almost a duplicate. If you look at these different ones, action open, like if I click between these, they're really the same thing over and over again. The only difference is the page that's selected inside of this action. So if I go to this action on each one, it's customer list versus dashboard versus tasks. And then, so now from that perspective, I've got these flows that open a page into a container, and those pages are dynamic and do their own dynamic things inside of them. It's like, those are their own self-contained dynamic things going on. So if I wanted to, I could do something like on page load, in that page binding right now, I just have this action open dashboard by default. I'm going to remove that. And instead, what I'm going to do is put a switch in here, which is a conditional. So we'll do a switch, and the test value I'm going to do in this case, you can get the value to test from anywhere, but what I'm going to do is get it from the request, and I'm going to get it from segment zero, which is the first segment. So whatever's after the slash. So if it doesn't find anything, I want it to go to dashboard. If it finds customers in there, I want it to do open customers instead. Okay, so what I just did is created a switch action that checks a value, in this case, the segment, but that can be anything. And then if it doesn't find anything in the segment, open the dashboard, which is now my default. Otherwise, go run through this list. So let's say I want another one called tasks. If it's tasks, then go open tasks.
Oh. Okay.
So now what I can do on refresh here, it's still opening dashboard because I don't have anything, you know, inside. Oh, and actually, yeah. So now if I go tasks and hit enter, now it goes and runs the tasks flow instead. So it just read what's in there.
Okay.
And if it matches, go do this. If it doesn't, do the default, right? So I can go, what was the other one? Customers, all right? So if I go customers and hit enter, now it's gonna go customers instead.
Right? That's dope, okay.
So basically, this is like, the concept here is single page web app, right? So I've got a single page, and I'm just opening other pages and other context into.
This is what I meant. This is like a server side include, but I get the dynamic side of it. Like Drew said, like it's a lot more than what I was expecting.
Exactly. I went through the same process myself with like coming from a PHP background. So that's why when you said that, I was like, oh, I know what's going to happen.
Oh, this is insane. Okay.
One thing you might do to like really get your head all the way around it is make another project and start from that other template. So if you go to projects list and go new project, select the SAS starter and just make a new project using that SAS starter. And
I'm actually going to do that. I'm going to do that because this gets me like 95% of the way there. Awesome. I was kind of freaked out by it because it had so many blocks.
Yeah. <it's a>
And just even Drew's user sign in thing kind of messed me up because I was like, it took me, I'm still trying to get the whole server side, because I was like, oh, you know what? I could just have it pop up in layers rather than, but it was then trying to wrap my head around how he encapsulated the light boxes.
Yeah. And that it's the same concept. Right. So like at the end of the day,
include that in that.
If you kind of like step back, the way Builder operates is you have these pages and you're providing the context of those pages. And then you're opening those pages when you need them to be opened. And you open those in primarily three ways. One is with the component element, where you select a specific page to load every time inside of that component. And that you're going to use for things like, this is a component header, right? So that header gets reused across all these, but it's a static thing. So that's
components are static. Divs will be more dynamic.
And then there's the open page action, which is what I'm using to do this dynamic thing, right? So like on click of this, open this page into that container. And then from there, I can have as many of those flows as I want and run them based on any kind of conditional I want. And then the third way to think of pages being used and reused like that is inside of a grid list, which is basically anytime you're going to list out a set of records. So that would be like here on this customer list. It's the same exact concept. It's just in this case, that row has the context of the grid, which was set with a bunch of data. And so the each row inside of there is going to have the context of that data.
But right.
In builder's terms, it's like these are all just pages and you're just reusing them how you need to.
Got you. So like in WordPress, that'll be like creating those micro code blocks and then inserting those blocks into other blocks. So it's kind of blocks inside blocks, but your blocks are whole pages.
Correct. Yeah. So I mean, I don't know the WordPress side.
Yeah, but it's the same thing. Yeah. And the way Builder takes it further then is like once it's included on the page, as far as Builder is concerned, like rendering and interacting and running, it's like, it's not even an include. It's like, it's just there with everything else. It can interact with everything else. You can set and retrieve variables across all the pages, run flows across all the pages.
So I started understanding that with the UI, like, because when you was helping you, when you were both of you were helping with the UI thing, the last question I had, I then had to take a step back because I was trying to go towards the using Bootstrap. And then I realized, wait, you can code every action on the browser in real time. Why am I going to a whole nother thing to do what I already have access for? So I have to take a step back and realize I can do what I want. A hover's right there. A swap out of text is right there. I'm not going anywhere else. So it's kind of trying to wrap my head around the fact that I've been always having to look for something else and I need to stop.
Drew literally used to say it like that. That's a really similar statement to the kind of thing Drew used to say. Because coming from a developer's perspective, you just have certain expectations of how frameworks operate, you know, and Builder's just different in how it operates.
It is the framework in itself. And because every time it's like, I'm looking for something else. All right, do I need another module? It's like, oh no, I watched a video with you, Mark. And it was like, oh, I can go over here and I can go to the NPMs and I can just run it in here. And then I can write my code on top of it. I'm like, oh, well, why am I being a bonehead? I can just go grab the code over here for a slider and throw it in. And that's where, when you were working on the NFT project, I was like, well, why should I stop where he's doing with the generation of graphics? Like, I can make a banner. Yeah. That banner can come from graphics. That stuff can be dynamic. He's doing it where he's clicking in and he's hooking it into his MetaMask wallet. But all of those actions could come from a remote source via APIs or from something else. Oh, y'all are working on something and I meant to ask you, y'all are opening up your thing for APIs. Correct.
Yeah. So we're working on the data APIs for the backend data that's inside of the collections that you're building. So like in here, if I go to the collections list, so I've got a set of customers in here, which there's just one customer in this case. But in here is where you'll have the ability to basically set up endpoints against collection.
Please. Because I can use N8N I come from the Citibank private bank where it was macros. Mm-hmm. And that was back in, I want to say 2004. And then I left to become a developer because I was a web designer at the time. And I realized web design was going away to content management systems. And then I learned, I picked PHP over Perl. I picked WordPress as the content management system. And I've been looking at automation systems and I realized that, you know, went from macros to then integrated platform as a service.
Mm-hmm.
And now things like N8N, they just launched something called N8N Desktop, which now means I can turn any Windows machine basically into a little micro API machine. So I can mean scraping, that means I can do all this processing work on a Raspberry Pi. Yeah. And then I could then just interact with any API, cloud APIs, which means I could just use y'all as my data source and the websites could literally be personalized. I have a chef right now who's my future fiance because we just got engaged. And I do all of the data for her. And right now I'm getting ready to work with their, she's doing from kitchen straight to the house. And there's this agency that's growing and they're looking for marketing and they're looking for me to help. And I was like, well, look, I'm looking at this new platform, which is y'all's. And I was like, I have something that can help you with your marketing because I'm going to grab data, be able to utilize marketing on multiple social media platforms. And I want one knowledge-based proof, which I learned from blockchain. I want to have the proof. And since y'all are working with Web3, I'm like, oh my God, this is crazy because not only could we then hook to any API on the planet, well, then they can hook to like Matic and I can stick it on the blockchain. And that data is now locked. So I could then put it on my resume and just say I'm a blockchain data developer for customers.
Yeah, we've got some fun stuff coming up with our, we're launching some NFT passes. And those passes are going to include premium templates and premium components and things for
for
Web3. And we'll be adding to that consistently. Like these are products that will just evolve over time, and they just require an NFT pass to get access to them.
That's one of the things we're thinking about too, because we were thinking for Toxic Hustle, like, because I'm working with multiple artists, and one of them is he's working with Jay-Z's producer. And I've been just sitting down and saying, I can see something where I'm like, okay, well, I make music and I have royalties. My royalties get paid. My royalties go to an account. And since I make my own music, uploading it to CD Baby, I'm like, and I'm in TikTok and everywhere else. I'm like, well, what if I could then open up the process of making music and tie all those data points? And I'm just scraping the data from, you know, from CD Baby, which is just a CSV file. I'm dumping that into this data system, and now I could basically give spreads and points. It changes the entire landscape of the music industry, because now what if I put that into a MetaMask and I throw it into a game, and then that game generates X amount of revenue and it comes back? Well, now people could buy licenses to contracts on an album before it's launched.
Yeah,
we could actually launch albums from the concept of the idea of the music sounding good and the message being important. And an artist could not be starving anymore. They could actually get paid to get their dreams to light and get their music to light. And that's kind of what my mission is.
It's crazy how NFTs have, I think the biggest value proposition for NFTs right now is that they provide seed funding that could never have existed before.
Ever.
For artists of all kinds, but also for software developers. Like, you put up an NFT pass and say, here's what I'm wanting to build. Here's an example of what I'm wanting to build. It's basically like private Kickstarter.
Right. And Kickstarter is getting in the game too. They just announced today that they're doing they're going to create a open source blockchain for doing the process of Kickstarters. So they're getting into the space, I guess, to try to get against OpenSea and things of that nature.
It's such a good move. And I think if they're doing it as, here's an open source blockchain with low fees, like that's a great move from them, you know?
Which is why I was looking at Matic so hard, because the fees were so low. And I could just store data, and the fact that you could like mine it or stake it and earn it means you had network effect of being able to push your content out. So in time, you could just look at it as a way to mass produce your content, and it costs you nothing. You could even create services similar to when the internet started, where people had domain names. Well, now you'll have these projects that launch. Like, we're thinking about how, if you look at Ego, Alter Ego, which is a television show of artists who are becoming avatars by using iPhones for catching their facial movements and motion capture suits with a Reillusion as a back end. So you can basically do real-time rendering of an artist singing a song in a virtual environment. You can do these concerts online in real time. That changes everything. With what y'all are doing as well, it gives us an access to being able to build these scalable apps. As a designer, I haven't seen since really Dreamweaver. Like, Dreamweaver was the first voyage. I was like, oh wow, if I sit here and learn this, really, I'm gonna get jobs. I'm gonna have jobs.
Oh my God. Dreamweaver, that's so old school. I haven't thought of that in a long time.
That's aging me. It's my leapfrog from web design, from graphic design, just learning Photoshop. Photoshop led me to Dreamweaver. Dreamweaver got me HTML. And then it was the company that built Wappler, DMX Zone, that got me into PHP.
Yeah.
And now y'all are the, like, that whole, do you know when you're going to launch that? As far as the connection to the API, like, I need it every day.
We've been at this long enough to not give people release dates before things are ready. So
okay. Like, that's the last piece, because I'm right now using I am using a MongoDB connected to Strapi API, hooked to an N8N database, so that I can try to fill the relationship, a Postgres database, so that then I can use Neo4j to just grab that data and stick it in as a graph file. Yeah. Because I don't know GraphQL and I'm scared to death of it.
Yeah, I mean, that's the problem, right? Is like, that's the thing that you kind of go two ways with big low code, no code tools. You either go, we're going to be a streamlined, we're going to allow these certain things to be able to be built, or you go, we're a monolith and you can build anything. Like, those are the two categories. And we're clearly a monolith. But our goal is, like, we don't actually care what part of our monolith you use. Like, some people come in and they only use it for the back end. They use something else for the website. Some people use it for everything. Some people use it for only front end, no data inside a builder. And they have a Mongo database with an API set up, and they do API calls for all their data and just use builder as a front end. You can use it however you want. And it's intentional. Like, we don't think there really is no end all be all technology to solve all pieces, you know? Right. But in terms of, like, the monolithic part, we think it's important to have enough of the pieces in place so that people can come and learn one tool set and get, you know, 90 or 95% of their app built without having to go to code. But realistically, you're always going to have to go to code somehow. You're always going to have to use some external source. You're always going to need to connect your thing to those external, like, it's just what it is.
Yeah. So, I've been learning that with my slider. So just being able to, okay, let me find the right slider with the least amount of JavaScript code that I can stick into a component and it be reusable.
Exactly.
I've loved this conversation so much, Jay, because, like, I can tell how excited and passionate you are about, like, what you're wanting to create. And when, like, that light bulb turns on and you're like, oh, I can do so much more than I thought. It's just, like, a really beautiful moment. And I'm glad that, like, we kind of got to see that.
I appreciate happen it. Like, cause
in,
it's
in this call.
It's been frustrating because I had to take care of my mom, who had Alzheimer's. And there was during last year. So I lost all my customers. I lost everything. And then I started figuring out the whole something told me go back to automation, and I went back to automation. And then I was like, damn, there's this one company and they're so close that if I could just get the automation to hook into their database, it would work. And I was running through all this other stuff. And then I went to Wappler, and then one day it led to Builder. And then I started watching Drew, and then I saw Mark's videos. And then I'm like, I'm still, again, I'm hunting for other things, and I'm realizing I need to stop.
I think, Cora, it's pretty clear. I mean, this is our first office hours, but it seems pretty clear that this is the way, like, just being able to, like, answer some of the community posts, help Alex in real time, get past that hurdle. Help Jay get past a hurdle in real time. Like, this is the way to go. I mean, it's really,
I think so. I'm glad we ended up, like, we threw this thing last minute. Even the guys were like, hey, you didn't even confirm the time with us. I was like, we're doing it. We're doing it.
Good call. This was very helpful. It's so helpful, y'all. Thank you so much.
I'm glad. So yeah, let's keep doing it. So we're at the hour right now. So I'll go ahead and call it, and we can jump off and go about our days. But yeah. Let's do it again next week, same time. So I'll chat the info, and then if you guys have any, like, nuanced questions, like, let's just jump on and get to them. And then I can always share the little snippets that we record. But yeah, thank you, Jay, for coming on. Thank you, Alex. Thanks, John, for just being here. And like your facial expressions are everything that I need to know about how something is going. So that's awesome. And Dorian, Drew, and Mark, thanks for answering all the questions.
And Emmanuel and Fraser, being quiet, but happy to see you.
What?
Happy to have you here. Yeah, they're in here.
Oh, guys, I didn't even see y'all here. Okay, awesome. Emmanuel, Fraser, thank you for joining. Cool. So we'll see you guys next week, and I will try and upload these little snippets later if it'll help anybody.
Thanks, Dave.
Thanks so much, guys.
Thanks, guys. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
See you guys. Yeah.